Richard Day, yes, it's proposed flax and the salmon mad. The salmon is more readily available to our body. The flax meal is broken down from the alpha linoleic acid in the body, translated to omega threes.
And then we just use a ice cream scoop or scooper, we scoop it up and we'll dish it out in parchment paper and cook it to the magic of UV. And we have a potty bag here that's already cooked. So, as far as plating, there are plates up here. We can start off with placing the greens now. I did save some lemon peel for garnish. We have one last step for the risotto. We have some pearl asparagus. These are pearl onions. So any kind of the more tender vegetables like those, you want to kind of hold it at the very end. So just before service, you kind of hold those in. People want them all separately or just before it's done. Just kind of give it a light hold, otherwise and then finish with just a little bit of Parmesan cheese. For a little bit of brightness, a little bit of lightness. And fold those. Should be a lot more cream than this, but obviously, to the magic of TV, you can look at the comment. Usually, this is about 45 minutes of time, right? The more you stir it, the more those starches get released into the sauce. And the thicker and creamier it becomes at that point. So, how was it? Challenge yourself a little bit next time, you're shopping, you're meal planning. How can I include some of those meals this week? How can I start getting the ready to go? Try something new at the further sections.
Thank you. Let's have another round of applause.
Actually, the benefits of the actual contamination.
difference.
Sometimes the farm raised will have a little higher fat content as well. What they're doing with sand right now is they're doing ocean raised, so they're doing farming, but actually helping the ocean. There's some huge nets that are floating, so the sand is being raised in the natural environment, even though they are being fed feed from food vessels, rather than naturally fertilized hog.
We also have a high-risk breast and ovarian cancer clinic, and individuals like this who believe they're at risk due to breast density or strong family history themselves referred to a high-risk breast clinic and be evaluated and go through this discussion, and then be referred when it's appropriate to genetics for evaluation and counseling. So always you can call the number, it's 855-SH-CANCER, and get into any one of our cancer clinics. So thank you. A friend of mine who had breast cancer decided any form of flax, because she believes it should not be my cancer survivors. Should flax be avoided?
Absolutely not. Previous research suggested that the consumption of flaxseed or even soy protein increased estrogen levels in the human body, as well as in mice or rodents. However, today we actually promote the use of flaxseed. It does not directly increase your estrogen levels in your body. This is the most recent research. The same with soy protein intake. If it's whole soy protein, at least 2 to 3 servings per day, does not in humans increase your estrogen levels. So I kind of jumped from flaxseed to soy, but that's basically the question that goes through.
Oh, and I just wanted to add too, when we're looking at including those foods, if you do have a hormone-sensitive cancer or you have a family history, then we recommend that you not take a concentrated source of those isoflavones. So that would be in like a protein powder that was a soy-based protein powder, or maybe a protein bar that was the protein was the soy. And actually, there are some studies from the early age, if you include soy into the and beginning populations to include soy and phytoestrogens from as early age as exposure to food type two. That's one.
So we really have a great team. We all want to talk. Y'all can be worried about it. This one, somebody's going to have to explain it. Prostate cancer. Low sodium diet and no vitamin K secondary warfarin. Yes, we have another mic.
With prostate cancer, I didn't know very much about that time. Was there, as far as ways of diet? We don't have anybody that I know of in the family yet, but I don't have a family either. You know, I have a husband and a son.
Yeah, for prevention for prostate cancer, then we talked about there have been a lot of studies out looking into this. Large trials. In terms of what we usually tell patients, what's good for your heart is good for your prostate. So a low sodium diet, we do recommend. The vitamin K, a modern amount of vitamin K is usually what's recommended, but of course the warfarin is affected by that. So, you know, that's all with a grain of salt. If you have a steady amount of that in your diet, and that would be for your anticoagulant. In terms of supplements and things of that nature for prostate cancer specifically, there's never been shown to be any proof that any supplements help prevent prostate cancer. There's a large trial that just finished about a year and a half ago that showed that. So no vitamin supplements and no other dietary supplements that help prevent prostate cancer. So kind of back to the old adage of low amount of red meat, reduced fat, and low sodium diet.
Thank you.
Another one about prostate. And that is, should I get a DSA test? And it's not.
Good. Women should not get DSA tests. And the controversies regarding the PSA test are a couple-fold. There are many studies, again, highlighting the benefits of the PSA test, and there are many studies highlighting that over-testing for prostate cancer leads to over-treatment of prostate cancer. So that's really the distinction to understand. And there's no doubt that the more prostate cancer we find, the more prostate cancer we cure. But it's also important to recognize that there are many prostate cancers that do not ultimately cause harm to men. So it's a discussion with your doctor. And we still believe, in terms of urologists, our society, our American society, several European societies still recommend appropriate PSA screening after discussion with your physician. Oftentimes that comes with your primary care physician. And so if your primary care physician has not had a discussion with you then, when you are 45 to 50 years old, ask them about that. And if they need to refer you for the 1 month.
The only thing I would add to that is, touch on genetics also. Family history is also very important. So if you have a father or brother that has a history of prostate cancer, then screening is very important to you as well.
Just to mention, one of two breast cancer genes we're seeing, she has a probably significant increased risk for especially early onset prostate cancer. We recommend that men start regular early prostate exams and the PSA blood test if they have, personally, if they carry a BRCA2 gene mutation. All right, for our chest, what is the exact coleslaw mix and what is the exact bread mix? I know there's a recipe book for the gut that uses a coleslaw mix. I think somebody wants a little more detail.
For the brain screen? It's actually a product in the company. But it's actually a product that we purchased from GFS. And they think it's a super sloth. It's called Soup. Yeah, it's a super sloth, so it's retail and muscle sloths, type of muscle sloths. And it's like, it's a recipe itself. So you can don't know if it's available at GFS Marketplace, but almost any store buyers might have been open to their own. I think how very wide the door is, like some deep greens or mustard greens, Swiss chard works well. And then really cooking goes down if you want to increase the bitterness and cook a little bit longer as well. But I think our ingredients
and
the nutrition wise, it doesn't much difference. As far as the rice blend goes, I use a pearl barley base because it simulates the Oreo rice as a little higher starch content. And then you can really add on top of that anything you want. Lotus slices. Lotus rice blends, or other whole grains of the machine. The more rice is really starchy rice. So the more you stir it, the more starch releases into the pot. So if you're going to switch from our Oreo rice to a whole grain, the more starchy your whole grains are, the better sorghum, stout. The more you stir it, the more starch is released in the pot.
So you just want to use a something that is already even white rice will get sick, it's like adding water to it. So brown rice kind of works, but it's nutrition.
Alright, back to genetic testing. When it comes to genetic testing, is there one test for all mutations or a specific test for specific mutations? There's always a specific test for specific mutations, but what we do now and what's the most expensive way to test is to do panels of several genes. That there are different types of gene changes we'll pick up with different techniques in that testing, but a panel of several genes usually addressing the genes that cover the risks seen in your family. So if you personally had breast cancer, and your mother had ovarian cancer, and your father and brother had colon cancer, we'd like to cover genes that we know are associated with ovarian cancer, breast cancer, colon cancer. So I think that was the question. If you're out there and that didn't cover it, please speak up. We can do gene panels of spectrum health that are extraordinarily large and small. And one thing I do want to mention about genetic testing is we're talking about testing your blood and your heredity, your mother, father, and how to pass down. You'll also hear about genetic testing of tumors. And don't confuse the two because we also have the technology and the ability to really do targeted therapies where we look at the cancers themselves when they occur and we can tell what's in them. And what kind of genetic makeup they have because they can mutate it. And we can then take drugs that we know will work with a certain mutation the cancer has, and we can target therapy. And it's called targeted therapy or personalized precision medicine. And we have that capability to do that as well. So that's kind of a fun fact. How can I go to three healthiest friends? So coconut oil and the three healthiest grains. Healthiest grains.
Okay, so I'll take the grains first. Which of several of these grains? I would say quinoa is very high in protein.
Can you spell it
for those people that hear me? I am no
Thank you.
Yes. So here's one. If you have had a skin cancer removed, are you considered at risk for skin and other cancers? If you've had a skin cancer, my first 10 questions are, is it sun exposure? Is it your skin type? Now, yes, you may be at greater risk for other cancers. Unusual situations, but the vast majority of skin cancers are going to be exposure to sun. Then you have unusual types of skin cancers that really may be a big red flag for genetic conditions. Sebaceous adenocarcinomas, how's that for one? And your skin doctor, I think, would say, let's have you see a geneticist. And then there's non-cancerous conditions that may also suggest that. Numerous basal cell cancers, especially for young, who have 30-odd basal cell cancers by the time they're in their 30s. Another hint that perhaps you should see genetics. Multiple family members with melanoma, especially early melanoma. Melanoma in conjunction with breast cancer and ovarian cancer. Melanoma along with the history of pancreatic cancer. So sometimes you may just have to ask your doctor, what do you think of this? Should we worry about something genetic? Because sometimes you just don't know. The other question on that is, do you need to say you have cancer and ask the question? So if you're talking about if you have skin cancer, ask for your cancer. The answer is absolutely 100% yes. Always tell your physician, or when you ask, if you're asked by a healthcare professional, if you have skin cancer counts. It depends what kind, as to how much it counts. So always tell your physician, because there are these very relatively obscure things that people might not really know that you can put together that form clues about what may be going on with your health. So yes, always say that. If you're talking about if you had cancer, somebody or your friends ask, it's not their business. I would say no if they ask, but yes, a healthcare provider does.
List good vegan proteins.
Tempeh, miso. All right, this is
An interesting question. What about cutting-edge treatments? Stem cells, bacteria, viruses used to manage and treat cancers. I can talk about stem cells. We have a blood barrels and transplant program. We do stem cell transplantation. We do that both for routine diseases such as leukemia, myeloma, also for some autoimmune diseases like scleroderma. And we also are involved in national cutting-edge trials for stem cell therapies and cellular therapies such as blood marrow transplant. Many of the other things that we're talking about with bacteria and viruses are still, most of them, are still very experimental. And we do have over right now about 227 clinical trials where we can bring cutting-edge therapy to patients for that are at risk for having cancer. So that's a short answer.
Not a ton more to add from the urology cancers side of things. Most of what we do as urologists are surgical management of cancers, and so that's a lot more on the medical side of management. There is a trial with a virus to treat prostate cancer that some people may have not heard of. We were really looking on the internet, and that turned out not to work out well. So still in experimental. Yes. So one of the exciting technologies that we're starting actually next month for prostate cancer specifically is something called the NeuroNav, which is targeted biopsy of lesions in the prostate. So traditionally we've done systematic biopsies for prostate without a target, and then that maybe you're on active surveillance for prostate cancer, so a low-grade, low-risk cancer, we want to make sure that they don't have any higher risk cancer that involves an MRI of the prostate, and if we see a lesion on the MRI, we can use this technology to go after that specific lesion, so we know exactly what we're doing with it, and helps with decision-making for treatment on the MRI. So very excited.
The last question I have is I don't fly often, but when I do use extra virgin olive oil. Do I have to worry about carcinogens due to hot, hot oil, such as popcorn, and olive oil? And it's a hot oil, and that's why I use it.
So, the American Cancer Society and the American Institute of Cancer Research recommends
whole proteins. So we're suggesting that you decrease your simple carbohydrates, whether it comes from white flour, sugar, so put more whole proteins to that is really going to help decrease your risk. Part of that we talked about is the fiber, the antioxidants that we have in our diets, decreasing your risk for colon cancer. So that's very important. And if you have cancer,
you still should follow the same recommendations because it's a healthy diet. Your body will function well under these recommendations. You'll help yourself go through the treatment and you'll have a better chance once you are in this collaboration of reducing your risk of future cancers as well. So it's a good lifestyle, healthy choice now and for the event that you have heart disease or cancer, still a good choice. So with that, you want to talk a little bit?
I just want to touch on the dessert.
When we created for your dessert this evening, there's a low fat ganache, a dark chocolate, and a couple of dark chocolate versus some chocolate. And then I use a fat free evaporated milk, whereas traditional ganache is made with cream and butter. This was fat free evaporated milk, and then rolled it in crushed granola. Raspberries and raspberries. That, and then there's a simple raspberry cookies with a thousand raspberries. Bring it up. Bring it to the stuff. Or chocolate?
So with that, I think we're going to conclude tonight. I want to thank all the people from the Spectrum Health Cancer Center, the chefs, our dietitians. Remember, these guys are certified in college of dietitians. They're really a great asset to our team and to beyond. Thank you very much for all the information, for all of you for coming out to help us live well, be well, and be well. Next month, our Dr. Dialogue is on living with Parkinson's disease, and that will be a discussion for both caregivers as well as family members. For now, we have sheets on the table for feedback. We really want liked about the presentation tonight, but if you didn't like, please make sure and do that as well, because we're all always striving to be better and better serve you as a cancer center and as Spectrum Health. So again, thank you all very much. Please fill out your card, make sure you have your parking pass, and join us next month. And the next Dr. Dialogue is April 28th. Leave your plates on the table. I'm doing this for some. Yeah.